Last Talk of the Morning by Marc Mézard from École Normale Supérieure and Paris Sorbonne, so what is PSL?
PSL, Paris Sciences et Lettres.
Paris Sciences et Lettres University, a new entity there. Okay. So, and a round, merry-go-round on replicas and everything.
Yes, thank you. I decided to that maybe for, because it's an anniversary conference that it would be a good idea to give a little bit of historical perspective on replica symmetry breaking. So I started from the beginning. So this is Giorgio's paper. It's actually published on 17th of September 1979, so it's very close to the real anniversary. I don't know if anyone in the audience will have a paper on the 17th of September out, but we will see. And in that paper, we may point out a few sentences of Giorgio. It is not evident how to parameterize a matrix in a zero-dimensional space. Sure, this is still true. And then he comes up with this ansatz with breaking what we would call now one-step replica symmetry breaking. And there is clearly in this paper there is this idea that you should not minimize but maximize the free energy at some point with respect to that new parameter. And then he does the computation of one step. The obtained value of the ground state energy is quite good. The negative value of the entropy is not acceptable. So, I mean, that is all the statements are there. And in the conclusion, it is quite likely that an infinite number of order parameters is needed in the correct treatment, and that the neglected order parameters have small effects at not too small temperature. So I think all these were perfectly correct in that paper. And the year after, as was hinted in the conclusion of the first paper, he comes up with this elaborate solution of the replicas. There is another paper that I like. I don't know if there will be a 40th anniversary of that other paper, but for me it was extremely influential and it very decisive in my decision to go towards Spinglass studies. That's the 83 papers on pure states. It was actually building on a lot of work of previous works by many people. Many of them are in the audience actually, and it was this idea that the Gibbs measure can be decomposed into sums of pure states, and that's one idea of let's say breaking of ergodicity, which was around just also because of the simulation of Peter Young and so on. But then there was this idea that actually the order parameter that Giorgio had introduced had a direct physical meaning in terms of overlap between these pure states. And so this for me was something quite striking, because in some sense it was projecting this abstract construction into the real world, something that one can touch. Let me make a few comments about what are replicas. I heard Francesco saying his own words on replicas, so I added the third point to acknowledge his own views of what is replicas. Maybe probably everybody has his own view. It started with this idea of an analytic continuation. You take z to the n and take the small n going to zero limit. But this analytic continuation, we know that it doesn't really work that way, in the sense that we have to interchange the large n, the thermodynamic limit, with the replica limit. And I think one better way, another way, let's say, to address the question is to look at large deviations. That is, you could say, I look at the partition function, I look at the density of free energy of one given instance, that's Fj for one given set of J. This one, it will obey a large deviation principle. Why it does, well, that's part of what the physicist will assume easily, let's say, and then we leave it to other people to prove it. But then if you assume that there exists a large deviation principle, then the thing that you should do, that you could do, is to say, let me try to use replicas in order to compute the Laplace transform. And from this Laplace transform, I can get, of course, the maximum, which is the free energy of the SK model, but also the full curve. There is this interpretation that Francesco told us about. And for me, there is one thing which is more interesting than all of this, in my opinion, about the meaning of replicas. which is the following. You have this decomposition of pure state. So roughly speaking, you say, okay, the partition function, I will split the space of a configuration, one corresponding to each state. And then I have the partition function, which is a sum of the partition function for each state. This decomposition, it may exist in systems without quench disorder. So systems for which you don't have to compute the expectation of log z, you don't need to have the replica limit. So now, if you look at the number of metastable states with a given free energy density, again, assuming a kind of large deviation principle, it will be given by e to the n times a certain function. This is called the complexity. And the idea is to compute the complexity with m, what I call clones. I am the only one to use this word, but I think it is important because it distinguishes between the original replicas. And the idea, and due to Rémy Monasson in 95, is the following. Basically, if you want to, it's again a Laplace idea. If you want to compute the complexity, well, just imagine that you take m clones of the system and you put each of them in the same state. And then if you compute the partition function of this thing, you get the Laplace transform of the complexity. This is true for one given instance. You don't need to do the average of a various systems. So basically, if you have a disordered system, these clones, I call them clones, you can replicate them. You can replicate on top of that in order to do the disorder average. But you can also use them, for instance, in structural glasses in which you don't have quench disorder. You can stop at the level of clones. So this m, so for instance, if you do it in glasses, you will say I will have m colors of atoms, and I will put them together. I will put a small attraction, epsilon attraction, between atoms of different colors. And basically, it's the idea of doing a theory of the glass by doing a theory of a cloned liquid. You take molecules with m atoms, and you study the limit where epsilon goes to zero, the small attraction between the various clones goes to zero. If they stay together when epsilon goes to zero, it means you are in glass phase, you are trapped. So that is, let's say, the basic idea. And in short, I would say that the basic idea of replicas is that for us, we don't know the pure states. It's very difficult to know the pure state. If we know them, then of course we have already solved the problem. But the systems knows it. So basically, there is always this idea of the replicas, which is you take another copy of the system that acts as an external field on the first copy and reciprocally. And that is how you get the things. From replicas to cavity. This is a long story that basically needed to understand two main ingredients. One ingredient was the ultrametric structure of the states with the ancestors and so on, and the other ingredient was to understand that the free energy densities of the state, they corresponded to a process of independent free energy, independent random free energies, even in the SK model. And that was very striking, that even in the SK model, you have these independent free energy. They are there in the random energy model by construction, let's say. But in the SK, they are also present. And this is true not only for the global free energy, but also if you take the set of states within a certain cluster, conditioned to being in the cluster, it's also true. And so this led to this mathematical construction of cascading free energy that became popular in the mathematics literature as a Ruelle probability cascade. So the cavity method, the idea was really to try to understand replica symmetry breaking and propose an alternative solution. And the idea was in some sense very simple. You take an n-spin system, you add an extra spin, and you have several assumptions. Again, one is the existence of the thermodynamic limit. It was not proven at that time, but it was a sensible assumption, let's say. And so if you look at that, then it will mean that the free energy will be extensive, and it means that you can compute the free energy density by taking the expectation value of the difference of free energy in an n plus one spin system and free energy in an n spin system. And then you have to analyze what happens on the new spin when you add this new spin, and it has a local field which has a Gaussian distribution if you are within one pure state. If you have many pure states, then the crucial thing was the exponential distribution, because the pure states, they have this exponential distribution, and the thing that happens is that if you add one new spin, every pure state sees its free energy shifted. And when they shift the free energy, it happens that the new distribution for the n plus 1 species spin system is again an exponential distribution, but it is shifted. And so, and computing the shift in this distribution is how you get the free energy density of the system. So that was crucial. Again, there was this idea of stability of the system in the large n limit. That is, when you add one spin, you get the same structure in the n and n plus 1 spin system in the large n limit. And there is only the exponential distribution of free energies that has this property. There was then the idea to go beyond to use all this construction in different systems. It took a small detour, and the detour was to try to understand what happened in diluted systems. And in finite connectivity systems, so for instance, if you look at finite connectivity spin glasses, well, again, you can do the same trick that when you have a finite connectivity system, you can look at the cavity field and see how it evolves. And in one pure state, you have a certain evolution. But then when you look at the mixture of pure state, you need to have, instead of taking just an evolution of a local field, you need to have the evolution of the statistics of the local field, and the replica symmetry breaking introduces a reweighting in the distribution of the local field. This proved to be something that was not exact, but gave a better approximation for spin glasses. So we had the same kind of conclusion for diluted spin glasses as Giorgio had for the SK. It improved the ground state energy, but the entropy is still negative, so it's not perfect, let's say. This generalized to many other problems of constraint satisfaction problems in which you have variables which are discrete variables. They interact by some factors, and you want to understand the probability distribution, joint probability distribution of all these variables. And they interact by factors in which each factor contains a finite number of variables. So there are many problems of this kind. Satisfiability, coloring, and so on, and you would like to be able to compute marginals, to sample, to compute the free energy, etc., efficiently. This can be done, to some extent, by looking, in some cases, by looking at what is called belief propagation. So you first do a factor graph representation. Each variable is a circle, and the factors which represent the interaction between the variables are the square. So for instance, here there is a triplet interaction between variables 1, 2, and 3. And then there is a pair interaction between variable 2 and 3, and so on and so forth. And the idea of the systems in which you can really solve the full problem is systems which are locally tree-like, in which this factor graph is locally tree-like. This happens if you look at random k-sat, random q-coloring, etc. They are locally tree-like. This means that if you cut an edge in this graph, then the typical distance between two points, it increases like log n. So this will be very useful in the sense that it tells you that you should dig a cavity. So you take, for instance, what is the probability of x1 in the absence of the constraint A? You can call it the message sent from 1 to A. It's a probability of x1. It's called a message. Then you can look at the probability of 1 only in the presence of C. I go fast because this is well known. This is a message C to 1 of X1. And you can close the equation by saying that if you look at the probability from 1 to C in the absence of C, it is a product of the incoming factors. And the probability from C to 2 is the probability of 2 in the presence of only this constraint. And you compute it by a simple marginalization condition. This is correct if you have a locally tree-like factor graph and if the correlations decay. The locally tree-like factor graph tells you if I have taken away this guy, then the correlations between 1 and 3, the points 1 and 3, they are very far away. I have to do a long loop over the log n to loop back. So if the correlations decay, then they will be weakly correlated and I will have the right to do my approximation. Then you can use this belief propagation equation. You could use them as algorithm. And you can do the statistical analysis of these equations. They are iterated with natural time iteration indices. Let's say you have the message at time one, this gives you this message at time two, with the message at time two, you get the message at time three, and so on and so forth. There is a natural iteration scheme, and you can monitor this iteration by looking at the statistics of the messages, and this is just the cavity method. So to summarize, we have a message passing algorithm. This message passing, it just exchanges message on the factor graph, and we can monitor these messages by computing their statistical properties, and the statistical properties at time t plus one, I get them by a simple dynamical evolution equation, which is just the iteration of the cavity method. And so it will tell us all the properties, the thermodynamic properties of these systems, and it will also relate to the replica free energy, for instance, because the cavity free energy and the replica free energy are the same, nearly by construction. In the case where you have replica symmetry breaking, it's more complicated because the local field, the one which characterizes the message, they fluctuate from one state to the other. And so you need to do something which is more complicated, which is to compute the statistics of the local field when you take a state at random. And so you have a probability that the local field, probability that the message take a certain value when you take a state randomly. And you have to compute this iteration of these statistics, taking into account the reweighting of the free energies. This can be characterized by some auxiliary problem, and it leads to the so-called survey propagation algorithm. And this gives you a tool to analyze a lot of constraint satisfaction problem. First of all, to get the phase diagram, and also to get powerful algorithms. So for instance, the phase diagram of satisfiability, in which when you increase the number of constraints, you go from a fully satisfiable case to a phase in which you start to have clustering of solutions. By the way, this was very interesting because all these pure states and so on in the SK model, they were always difficult to define at the beginning, at least. In KSAT, it's really clear because you say, what are the states, what are the configurations which are SAT and the ones which are not? And then you can group them, see if they are connected or not, and then you have you can get the definition of the clusters. And then you have condensation phase transition in which some of the clusters dominate. I want to go back to the fully connected problems in the last 5 minutes. If you go back to SK model, you can do exactly the same thing. You can use the belief propagation equation that we had written for the diluted systems, and you will tell me this is not a locally tree-like problem. But nevertheless, you can do it because the condition for using BP is not, it is the fact that the input variables, when you take out one edge, they are weakly correlated. And this is true in the fully connected models because of the interaction over the 1 over square root of n. So you have weak correlations, and this is well known. This has been known since Thouless, Anderson, and Palmer. And so you can write the belief propagation equation for the SK model. This is a magnetic field on the spin I in the absence of J. You compute it in terms of the magnetic field on the other spins at time t, and it gives you the new magnetic field at time t plus one. You can expand that because the J are small, and basically you can close them onto a purely local magnetic field, not the one of the cavity, but the full magnetic field on the site. When you do that, you expand the equation, it's a five lines computation, you get exactly the tap equations. Actually, it's one easy way to derive the tap equations. You get the tap equation with an extra input, which is that you get the right time indices. So the right time indices, it means that if you want to compute the new field at time t plus one, it's a function of the fields at time t and the fields at time t minus one. These are crucial. They were not noticed initially when we were iterating naively tap equations. And they make it, they can convert, let's say, the tap equation as an algorithm. And in this context, it's called AMP algorithm. Now, beyond, going slightly beyond the SK model, I wanted to point to some of the latest development, because I wanted to close the loop and finish with 2019 paper with replicas. And the latest point that I wanted to mention is the following. Imagine that you have the following inference problem. People have been working a lot on applying this idea of message passing to inference problem. Let me characterize one of them, which is easy to describe in the present context. Imagine that you have a spin configuration, xi. They could be easing spins or continuous spins or vector spins, whatever you like. And you have a planted configuration. So it's a configuration that you would like to find, but you don't know it. Instead of knowing it, what you know some measurements which are pairwise measurements. And the pairwise measurement, they tell you for each pair ij, you measure something which is the product xi xj plus some noise. And actually, the product is multiplied by 1 over square root of n, and the noise is of order delta, square root of delta here. And so this means that you have a very weak signal. If you look at one pair, the signal that would give you the product xi xj, it's reduced by 1 over square root of n, is completely hidden in the noise. But you have many measurements. We have n square over 2 measurements. So you can use them. And so the idea is, can you, from the measurement of these y, can you deduce xi star? If you do a Bayesian approach to that, we'll say, okay, I have certain prior on the xi. Let me assume that xi, I have assumed that they are binary variables or they are whatever. And then I have the probability of x given y is proportional to the probability of y given x, which is a Gaussian. And you see that if you expand that, you immediately get, especially if xi are binary variables, for instance, you get the SK model, basically. You get the SK model. But if you do it carefully, you will find that it is the SK model with a ferromagnetic bias. And the ferromagnetic configuration, all spins up, is a gauge transform of the transformation xi star. And the question is whether you find it or not. Then there are two basic cases that you can look at. One case is the one where you have perfect knowledge. If you have perfect knowledge, you can use in this formula the prior P of xi from which xi star was generated. If xi star was generated by some prior, you use it. You can use the delta, which is here. You can put the delta naught. Sorry, this one should be delta naught. It's outside of the screen, but you can use the right shape of the noise if you know it. If you do that, then you plug in delta equal delta naught and P equals the 1 of x star, and you get something which are called, that we have been calling for many years, Nishimori conditions. And it tells you that this system is replica symmetric, and it tells you that you can solve it by our beloved method. You can write the BP equation, transform them into tap equation, iterate them, build like that what is called now the AMP algorithm. And you can get the exact control of the AMP algorithm by looking at the evolution of the statistics of the messages. It works. It's a fine algorithm. It retrieves the hidden configuration when delta naught is less than 1. It means that if the system is not too noisy, then you can retrieve it. It means that you are in the ferromagnetic phase of the SK model, let's say. If delta naught is too large, it does not converge. What happens if you are not able to do the optimal bias approach? When then you can run into trouble because you are no longer on the Nishimori line, so you can have replica symmetry breaking, and you are kind of lost. And so one way, which was proposed recently by Antenucci et al., is to go back to clones. That is basically one thing that you could do. You remember this small picture that I was presenting at the beginning? Well, you do the same thing. You say, now I will introduce M copies, M clones of my problem. Instead of solving it for one xi, I want to solve it for the first clone, xi with index a equal 1, and then solve it for the clone with index 2 and up to index m. Okay? I've done nothing. I've never done anything when I do clones. I start to do something when I impose, when I put in a small coupling that puts the clones together. And so I can do that in the message passing. And then by doing that, it turns out that this parameter M is exactly like the Parisi parameter. You can write the message passing equation. They are analytic in M, so you can look at them for M smaller than one. This is a main lesson that we learned from page one of Giorgio's paper. And looking at that, you get the AMP message passing algorithm with the clones kept together by a Gaussian coupling. This algorithm, you can do its state evolution. It will be equivalent to the 1RSB cavity method with Parisi parameter M. And it turns out that if you choose M correctly, it should be less than 1. Sorry, but that is life. And if you choose M correctly, this algorithm is able to converge in some regions in which the original one was not able to converge. So I think this is interesting. I wanted to mention it in order to close the loop back to the replicas. I said that I wanted to go from algorithms also to replicas. Here I am. I have cloned the algorithm itself. And so being back to replicas, I just wanted to underline. Last year I was mentioning in this room that my first encounter with replica was in this lecture of Giorgio. In the written lecture, I was not in Les Ouches, but I was reading his paper, and there was this comment that I was always finding very, very striking and scary. It is clear that there is no bound to the number and to the form of the solutions we can consider. When the replica symmetry group PN is broken, and then there was a comment on the instantons in replica space that I will spare for you, Pandora's box is open, and we gain nothing by closing it again. So Giorgio went to open this box of Pandora. And since last year, I did a little bit of homework, and I found out that actually there is an academic dispute on Pandora. And because the interpretation that is most common is due to is based on a text of Hesiod. And Hesiod was saying that opening the Pandora's box releases all evils upon man. Okay? But there is a dispute, there is a scholar debate, and some people say that at Pandora's box, at some point, might also have contained only good things for mankind. So I will leave you with this debate. I'm sure we can contribute to that, because in the end, with replicas, we have contributed to so many things that maybe we can contribute to the debate on Pandora's box. And certainly, good or bad, it was certainly a very fascinating box that you open, rich and fun. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there questions about the Pandora box? Yes.
I didn't catch the how do you practice using them in the last slide?
Ah, in the cloned algorithm. Well, you choose the M empirically so far. There is one, others are here, several probably. I see Lenka, probably, Francesco is here also. No, I mean, there is one criterion which is good, which is that you try to find an M, the parameter M, in which you have one criterion, which is that the overlap should be equal to the magnetization, that you are getting back, in effect, to something which looks like the Nishimori line. And so that seems to be a very efficient way to do things. But apart from that, at the moment, as far as I know, unless there has been progress since the paper has been published, they don't have a way to let the M evolve, let's say, dynamically in order to find the correct value. It is a value which is between 0 and 1, that is clear. Well, that has to be, it's not a surprise. But how you find it, it's not yet known. But you can experiment with various M's and see which one gives you the best mean square error.
I have a very quite similar question, actually. The position looks like when you follow states in time version.
Like you follow what?
States in time version. For example, as we did with Ramanujan, you have some states that dominate a given time. Then you change them, like you have this delta here, change vectors, similar to change vectors. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And there are cases where states disappear into nothing. So could this happen here?
I think as far as I know, I mean, so far, this idea, it has been explored in this paper that I was mentioning, recent papers, which was really on this inference problem. And there is a kind of connected idea, remotely connected idea, which is all the developments around the team around Riccardo Zecchina, in which he also uses some kind of clones in order to address, for instance, learning in the binary perceptron, these kind of hard problems in which he says that one can get a much better algorithm by cloning. But I think that our knowledge is very poor at the moment. We have a couple of examples, but we didn't really see what you say. But it's quite possible that there is a class of systems in which this idea can work and not all.
Yes?
When you have
full RSP, when state becomes
well, I mean, it depends. Conceptually, the thing is easy. Practically, it becomes quite complicated rapidly because, I mean, you see, if you think at the passage from the simple BP to the one step thing, you start from exchanging messages on the edges. A message is a probability distribution of a variable. So if you have a binary variable, the probability distribution is just a local field. So that's a number. You exchange a number, that's the simplest thing. Then you go to one step RSB, you have to do the statistics of these numbers over many states. So it's a function, it's a probability distribution of the local field. Go to two RSB, you need to do one probability distribution of the probability distribution. And technically, to put it on the computer, you will run into, it's not impossible to do because you can always sample, but it takes large amount of time. So I mean,
there is no shortcut somehow.
There is not really a shortcut so far, but there should be. But it is
quite
it is very different from the standard.
Giorgio, you have.
I'd like to say two things. First of all, concerning the method of putting groups, there's something similar that was done by Zecchina, but use large value of n.
Yes, that's what I was saying. Yes, yes.
Therefore, it would be nice when Ricardo is here.
Yes, to connect them. He used a large one, yes.
The other thing, can you show the second slides? The first slide, I want to do a short historical remark. Next. Okay. After the sentences that you have underlined, the paper that was submitted, one I was remarking that you can do the same kind of symmetry breaking in that paper in a hierarchical way. And that was submitted to the review. The referee made the comment that the paper could not be understood. Just because the number that was quoted was in agreement with the simulation, the paper should be published. However, the remark on hierarchical symmetry breaking was not worth the paper on which was written, and therefore it should not be published.
Well, you kept something there in the conclusion. The generalization of equation 2 is rather trivial.
Yes, but there was a limited
so there was no hierarchical or whatever, it was just trivial.
Thank you very much. So we should thank the speaker of this morning.